So I'd like today to attempt to bring up a point that I think that for the study of religious or spiritual experience, for the successful study of religious or spiritual experience, there needs to be done a reconceptualization of consciousness, analogous to the one which kind of happens between classical phenomenology and phenomenology of life in the rendition of Michel Henry. And in the recent years, it's possible to see a convergence between discourses in phenomenology of life and phenomenology of consciousness. And there may be a phenomenology of consciousness, new developments that I may not be even familiar with. So I'm leaving much space for improvement in this proposition that I will be making today. But nevertheless, I would like to outline a couple of distinctions in between ordinary experience and experience of religious or spiritual quality, which I think warrant a suggestion for the need of reconceptualization of consciousness. And a lot has been said today about the difficulties of identifying religious experience as a valid category or as a valid research subject. So I won't be again recycling this point, but I'd like to say though that often there is a new category out there, which is spiritual experience, or at least it's a common sense signifier, which is used quite broadly. And there are differences between religious experience and spiritual experience, which Henri's approach allows to identify. But for the purpose of this talk, which is to introduce the distinction in the concepts of consciousness, I will roughly relate to religious or spiritual experience as one group of experiences which are characterized by a specific quality, which the qualities which we yet don't know exactly fully, maybe how to do. So the two data streams in research of religious or spiritual experience are anthropological findings, or anthropological data stream, and textual research. And both of them reveal a specific set of findings, but textual evidence, I think, brings up more limitations or more demands in terms of working with the historicity or cultural, historical aspect of inconstitution of experience and inconstitution of text. And there is also a problem which I wrote about previously, of identifying first-person experience in textual evidence. While this problem clearly is absent in working with anthropopsychological evidence, and that is why today I'd like to limit, or mostly limit, my report to anthropopsychological findings. Regardless of their origin, whether they are though coming from textual research or found in anthropopsychological findings, and whether this experience will be caused intentionally by some form of meditation or prayer, or will have a more sui generis emerging quality, they will stand out of the ordinary flow of consciousness, which is, in our understanding, a secularized consciousness. One of my research informants recently characterized this quality as being transfixed. The otherworldly quality is not, this otherworldly quality is not universally acknowledged, In recent debates on the philosophy of religion, a radical perspective by Zagwill equals the Kantian argument that since God is not an object, religious experience doesn't exist. This further leads to suggestions that religious experience is simply a phenomenon of language in the work of Czolgosz. Zagwill assumes religious or spiritual experiences must be predicated on God's existence by being the knowledge of God. But as shown by Schmidt-Sperrin and others, the original idea of phenomenology has been to study God without God, that is, to clarify not the theoretical possibility of revelation, but the facticity of revelation. Alice Bello indicates that Husserl believed that religious or spiritual experience, which he termed intimations of transcendence, are constitutive, not optional, to consciousness. And it is from here, if one shows the revelation as essential to consciousness, conclusions concerning the nature of reality can be further drawn. It has been suggested that the structure of experience in religious introspection is determined by texts, that is in the work of Pena, Gimelo, and Flood, and social practices by Geertz and Jensen. However, it is unclear how deeply texts and practices penetrate into constitutive layer of experience and whether it can impact the formation of primal impressions which are relevant to religious or spiritual experience. Schleiermacher, Otte, Lonergan, Marion, Steinbock, Nancy, just to name a few, ascertained that religious experience possesses a distinct and structural phenomenological core, and such a core may be free of cultural relativity. Marcel and Henri, independently and in different ways, indicated that the modes of religious knowing are broader than our knowledge of them, and that they don't have necessarily to be limited to object-related intentional modes. Another matter complicating research of religious or spiritual experience is the issue of first-person authority. First of all, religious experience is not a commonly shared erfahrung, and reporting of them can be associated with stigma in some professional circles. Second, there are ethical or status limitations on such reporting in religious traditions themselves. This contributes to the alleged polymorphism of religious experience by making it less recognizable and by creating difficulties in second-person research. We cannot say in how many situations a religious experience is experience of God or of intimacy with God, or what exactly is termed by spiritual or sacred, how or in this context. However, in most cases, for example, as shown in the recent collection of studies on religious experience by Hunt and Caputo, or in the recent Truth Within by Flood, religious experience necessarily include a sense of ultimacy or certainty. Winters directly terms religious experiences of ultimacy. If, as it is for Ricoeur or Cassirer, constitution of religious experience happens in and by the symbolic horizon of consciousness, whereby the essence of such experiencing can be determined by whether a religious symbol met and fulfilled the intentional contents of experience, one must inquire how is it that endlessly mutational symbolic or mutable symbolic objects can fulfill intentional contents correlating to the persistent sense of truth or ultimacy. By contrast, Henri's material reversal of phenomenology suggests that the religious essence of experience should be sought after in the horizon of phenomenological materiality. Such approach would Sorry, I can't find a place where I can read this text. such a broad would link religious or spiritual experience to something much more permanent than symbols which degrade as any mental image in a matter of seconds. Henri doesn't focus his account on the facticity of separate instances of religious experience that will be largely irrelevant to his purpose. And the purpose is to demonstrate the genetic connection between the essence of appearances and the Christian religious myth. However, if one uses Henri's findings to formulate a phenomenological approach to the study of experience along the lines of human science, to make such approach suitable for applied research, there is another advantage in such approach besides it suggesting a phenomenologically permanent ground for the phenomenologically permanent sense of ultimacy or truth. In Henri's phenomenological universe, the objectives to existence of religious experience, which are based on Kant's argument, become irrelevant. Extending material phenomenology towards epistemology opens considerations for non-intentional knowledge, which is the knowledge without knowledge. The paradoxical nature of such knowing is exactly what is stressed in Philokalia by St. Vesicius the priest, who talks about enfleshed prayer, which produces experiences of the sure knowledge of incomprehensible God, that is, experience of knowledge of God, which cannot be comprehended in things or as things. If I do you mind if I will
open the curtain now? It's not
okay. Let's try that.
It's the other one.
The center one.
No, I think I should go there. Because we run out of ink, and this is printed in red. So. Okay. Clearly, thank you. I'll be speaking from here. I should do it. Clearly, a non-intentional perception and or knowledge which is intentional in a moment that doesn't require, in a manner that doesn't require an object, is not available in reflective strata of experience. Experiences of knowing of such quality has been described, for example, in aparoksha, that is a type of knowledge referred to in Hindu literature by Shankara, or in Suravadian concept of light. But the descriptions can also be confusing in terms of directness of their signification, giving rise to the idea of languages of unsaying as in cells, and giving rise also to problems in translations. Manifestations of phenomenological materiality, highlights, environment, etc., are among the most difficult to recognize in textual evidence. That's what basically Haro's talk, I think, demonstrated very well. In anthropopsychological research, tension between reported embodied certainty of religious inexperience and uncertainty with regard to what kind of knowledge such experience delivers and thereby its existential status is characteristic for this whole field of study. Therefore, I will proceed, as mathematicians would say, in approximation, which usually occurs when an exact numerical number, or in our case, phenomenological denominators of this form of experience is unknown or difficult to obtain. I will rely on self-identification of religious experience by the subjects and such identification was in most cases empathically shared by this author, who myself am a teacher of contemplative practices which are intended to cause religious experience. The report that I will be using, or the data that I will be using in this study, will be mainly limited to anthropopsychological findings for the above mentioned reason. They come from more than 5,000 accounts which will spread over different data streams for a period of 20 years. And I think that that's what we're actually facing when we you know, research religious or spiritual experience. This is this immense hermeneutic complexity of the data streams which need to be integrated for this knowledge, even if research is limited to anthropopsychological findings. So what we have here is reports of emergent experiences, accounts of neurocorrelation, because there is a lot of good descriptions of experience which are footed now by finding neurocorrelation in publications such as Frontiers of Human Science. Reports of exemplars, reports from large groups with non-religious introspection, because people practice introspection and then they get religious experience or even an experience of conversion, and it's completely out of the blue, and these experiences can be of different quality, but they are all across the board will be characterized by the denominator, this is religious experience, and with certainty so. So ethnographic data from religious groups have to be collected, and there are quasi-experiments which can be conducted with guided introspection, and of course, first-person examinations have to be included, otherwise we cannot do phenomenology. So in preparation for phenomenological analysis, when we start doing analysis of this evidence, consciousness as such is extracted from experience which happens in the natural attitude by the first phenomenological reduction. From this first reduction, the phenomenological method proceeds towards clarification of the layer of consciousness knowledge understood as intentionality. Theoretically, in clarification of religious or spiritual experience as a form of experience, the same should apply. However, if intentionality indeed stands for the tension that connects us with what seems to be outside of us, and I'm quoting verbatim from the recent publications on Husserl's phenomenology, such understanding of consciousness immediately kills religious experience as a subject matter of research. Why? Religious experience doesn't reveal anything external to oneself. On the contrary, they disclose something which is intimately inside us. Religious experience and religious cognition are always associated with internality. Alice Bell referred to interiority as a privileged point of departure in the formation of religious sense. Crowley earlier stated that as soon as we decipher introspection, we will know the genesis of revelation. Even Flood, who studied interiority thoroughly in its cultural context, and believes it to be a configuration of ideal of the self projected onto the idea of the body, as opposed to body qua mind as a Marcel, Flood avoids interpreting his data as the study in intentionality of consciousness. Here is an account of the beginning of religious introspection from an Indian spiritual master, Harilakshmi Punjaji, also known as Papaji. I was sitting there, and so this is videotaped, this account. I was sitting there and waiting for Krishna. Then his teacher, Sri Ramana Maharshi, comes by and asks, what are you doing? Oh, sir, I'm playing with my Krishna, sir. He is hiding from me. Where is Krishna? I'm waiting for him to come to me. Krishna is inside you. So I stopped looking out for Krishna. Krishna is inside, and then Papaji points to his chest. That is where Krishna is. So by comparison, here are the pictures with ecological gesturing. And this is, of course, in icon art, in religious art in general, these are gestures which point to the subject. Another very interesting feature in the icon art is the reverse perspective, which basically is supposed to throw attention onto subjectivity. So in examples like this, we have the whole, this is symbolic, of course, but there is the whole depiction of the inner man, and it's introspective, it's internal. So another textual example from the Philokalia, in the fragment Three Methods of Attention and Prayer, which is attributed to Saint Simeon, the new theologian, 10th century Common Era, gives instructions to ascetics who intend to practice prayer, which brings about religious experience, as following. Rest your beard on your chest and search inside yourself with your intellect so as to find the place of the heart where all the powers of the soul reside. This term inside in religious introspection is neither symbolic nor does it happen in the realms of ideas, as an idea interiority of interiority projected onto a body idea. It is radically empirical and personal and resists objectification. As James wrote in The Varieties, the first thing the intellect does with an object is to classify it along with something else. But any object that is infinitely important to us and awakens our devotion feels to us also as if it must be sweet, generous, and unique. Probably a crab would be filled with a sense of personal outrage if it could hear us class it without ado or apology as a crustacean and thus dispose of it. I am no such thing, it would say. I am myself, myself alone. So there is in this return to the embodied self in religious introspection, there is a melange, there is an amalgamation of the sense of personal uniqueness or the sense of encounter, the sense of specifics, very sacred quality to that introspection, and the introspective turn of attention. Alone with the alone, anxiety, those heavenly moments when a sense of divine anxiety invades me, is the theme of religious inquiry. It doesn't begin with mental scrutiny. It starts with the focus on the body qua mind, that is a living body which can neither fully become an object. Emotion of attention into the body self is reflected in an ecological gesture, and the mystical financial attitude turns to the self exactly because God is not found among objects. Gangaji, a modern teacher of Vedantic mysticism, described it as turning where you never turned before. Bodily interiority persists as the field of religious or spiritual experience, very differently from phenomenological, the body in phenomenological investigations, in which inside and outside is exactly what is lost to classical phenomenology's first reduction in its reaching for awareness. So, in phenomenological discourse, just to elaborate a little bit on that, introspection is not considered because phenomenology treats the phenomenal field not as something inside oneself or outside of oneself. I mean, the regions of inter and intrasubjectivity are outlined, but introspection, this kind of return, this is something which was used by Brentano in his categorizing and descriptive method. And then Heidegger and Husserl were very critical with regard to Brentano's use of natural or Cartesian categories, and introspection or external and internal is one of the divisions which are really Cartesians, so that was discarded in the method as a part of the first reduction. So that is just one of the examples when the mental operation in religious or spiritual experience is overridden by classical phenomenological method. Okay. Because we are talking about this return to the self, I would like to spend a couple of minutes talking about self-awareness as non-objectifying, awareness as compared to material self-awareness in Henri. So,
that is a long power.
So we have to build, I think, with this PowerPoint and then just simply avoid reading some slides. So, or describe. So when introspection takes place into the materiality of the body, mystics experience a graduated spectrum of absorptive states. That was described in Buddhist jhanas, but it is described even to a higher degree in the fragment of Philokalia on the ladder of divine graces. And so I will now actually bring this ladder. I think I know how to find it in one of my presentations. So this is an example of the poetic description of this ladder, and let's see if here I think it will be visible a bit better. Okay. So the first step is that of pure spray, then there comes warmth of heart, and then a strange holy energy, the tears run from the heart, God, you, the peaceful thoughts of any kind, etc. So the phenomenological reporting of this condition produces a layering, which here I termed hyletic reduction, but there is no hyletic reduction, you know, it's a spectrum of stratified states in absorption, which have degrees of tangibility as their chief characteristics. And so this kind of phenomenon was very puzzling to me and very difficult to explain within the frame of Serbian reduction. Well, okay, Tai Pale in his recent work introduces, articulates self-awareness as hyletic, and refers to both Merleau-Ponty and Henri in context of interpreting primal impressions. But just to give you an example of those differences, there is a self-affective quality, kind of sensing themselves or being sentient, feeling that they exist, which is non-intentional or supposedly somehow intentional in the primal impression as self-affective. And so in work, let's say, by Tai Pale, when he refers to both Merleau-Ponty and Henri, it appears as if both thinkers were interpreting primal impression or this density component, which we are talking about here, in similar sense. However, Henri was very critical of Merleau-Ponty, and exactly with regard to his understanding of the body, which for Henri is impacted by the Husserlian logic of interrogation, in which intentionality dominates the picture and the essence of the body will be reduced to reversibility and thereby misunderstood. There is no reversibility whatsoever in the spectrum. The moment condition is objectified, it disappears. So it's available only in absorption, and that's where it retains its spiritual quality. Hence, so if one uses Merleau-Pontian framework or Husserl's framework as opposed to Henri's framework, the results and the understanding of what's happening in the phenomena like this one differ a lot. And reductions I already spoke about, and the fact that when I tried to use hyletic frame for interpreting this phenomenon, it didn't really work, while Henri frame of reference appears to work. Chronologically, the body-related reinterpretations of subjectivity and phenomenology of consciousness happened in the context of paradigmal shift from postmodernist absence of the self to post-postmodern interest in subjectivity, re-emerging interest, which affected science and brought to life theories of engaged cognition. So since engaged cognition theorists absorbed Merleau-Ponty's findings in the structure of behavior, the body and its hieratic has been phenomenologically approached as a field of engagement in the world. The means of this engagement for science are visual and tactile and not haptic, not tangibility. Hieratics is now regarded in phenomenology in a similar manner, which is a subjectively embodied field of engagement with the world, and not as a field of introspection, which is essential for religious or spiritual experience. So for example, if I were to interpret something like this phenomenon from the standpoint of understanding of the hieratic component in Husserlian phenomenology, and I may be wrong, you know, but that's my understanding. I will have to look at hieratics as something which mediates and discloses relationship with the world, and something in which interaction between subjectivity and the world becomes experienced and communed, and that will give me no clue whatsoever to understand religious or spiritual experience unless I want to reduce it or understand it in context of the impact of the world. That's basically important. In Husserl's early work, intentional consciousness is completely abstracted from hieratics, which is later interpreted as sense data onto which meaning is bestowed, which is, in the early phenomenology, is interpreted as sense data onto which meaning is bestowed. Later, in the analysis of the internal time consciousness and primary impression, this stance is corrected in favor of passive synthesis and primary impression. But the relationship between hieratics and intentional consciousness are never fully clarified. Henri's critique of this is as following. This route of self-correction, that's a quote from Henri, from the idea of consciousness as something which can be easily abstracted from the other components of experience, to embrace the idea of consciousness as field of human entanglement in the world, doesn't help understand the basic feature of consciousness, which is that its content is filled up by things other than itself, known as transcendence. The description should be disclosing of the how of constitution, but the study of intentionality tells us nothing about the real nature of intentionality. The study of reversibility of the body tells us nothing about the real nature of reversibility of the body, and the rehabilitation of sense data from mere repository of intentional conscience to constituting hieratic data do not help us understand the essence of appearances or appearing. Further, Henri argues that this nature will remain out of reach as long as phenomenology commits itself to having beginning and end in the study of consciousness. In Henri's account, and in other phenomenologies of life, the point of departure in philosophy should be life, not consciousness, and certainty, not being. Life, for Henri, is given to itself both factically and indirect intuition, as distinct from eidetic intuition, which emerges in life upon reflection, or self-reflection. Henri's work in the phenomenology of life can be grouped in three sections. His material phenomenology occupies a structural place similar to the method and descriptive phenomenology in the phenomenology of consciousness, but it is not developed to the same degree of detailing of its operative concepts. The second section of his analysis would be a descriptive phenomenology of life, which also further becomes metaphysics of manifestation. And the third segment would be philosophy of religion, which is dedicated to the analysis of Christian revelation. So I will now skip Henri's argument against the Husserlian conceptualization of the body and proceed to relationship which I want to demonstrate between religious or spiritual experience and purified materiality, because when Henri talks about materiality, phenomenological materiality, being an essence of all appearances and constituting the body, and he basically refers to phenomenological materiality as the ultimate constitutor. What is it that he means? So, so I will again give an example from the study of Vedantic text by students of the author. They are reading and trying to understand changes in self-awareness occurring while Vedantic text of 15th century Advaita Makaranda is read. And the text consists of verses like, in me, in my space of awareness, rises the celestial city known as the world. How then am I not the nature or the heart of all? Space cannot be dried, burned, drowned, or stabbed. Yet air, fire, water, weapons are as real as space itself. Then how can they destroy me when they're imposed on my space of awareness? And then the method itself, which is used in Vedanta, differentiation between the seer and the seen, is very similar to Husserl's reduction in terms of the directional epoche, searching for certain regions of awareness. So not the body, not the senses, and not the breath, not the mind, the intellect, they are seen as mind, and the mind, they are known as this. So what happens in those reductions, however, is that attention, there is an attentional modification, which is sort of like orthogonal inward motion towards subjectivity. And I tried here to illustrate how this motion happens in absorption, but there are also other pictures which show how this attentional reconfiguring happens. For example, this one. That's internal prayer. And so if one interviews praying people, introspectively praying very precisely, then there is reconfiguring, attentional reconfiguring of self-awareness, which happens in this manner. And there is also emergence of, this slide. Interesting, increase of density of somatic self-sense in the region of the chest. So it's nearly like Straussian ego, which is embodied ego, because Strauss wrote about motions of the embodied ego center through the body. So it's as if Straussian ego is becoming reconfigured, and then absorption happens and negation of all the components of the mind, they happen into this influential embodied centralized sense of self in the chest. And so what, coming back to this picture of absorption, which I have many out of those findings, there is a certain layering which emerges in absorption, and it's always orthogonal towards the self. And then let's say the matrix is, first of all, it's temporal, and then it's organized by something. And so what subjects report in those exercises, they report a change of density in internal perception, which corresponds to the rise of the cognitions described in this poem. So when the poet writes here, the layering, the piece of thoughts, from thoughts of every kind, from there as a purging of the intellect, and that's the vision of heavenly mysteries. What organizes this spectrum is a, well, material matrix, the phenomenological materiality enfleshed a fleshed sense which has certain gradient, and it does. I mean, I tried to interpret it initially as maybe, you know, we can attribute some kind of kinetic intentionality to these impressions, but this is not a linear process with certain stages. It's more like nested temporality of sorts with stations, which has complex internal organization, which is nearly fractal. So if I were to depict metaphorically the differences between intentional universe in Husserl and material phenomenological universe of Henri, the distinction would be this. So this is the intentional, you know, reaching out for out of myself, and that's how my cosmos is organized. Here, there is, for Henri, there is no ecstasis. So the Heideggerian concept of ecstasis of being will be completely alien. It's all within materiality as if enclosed within itself. So it's a system which presupposes metaphysical unity and allows to resolve lots of philosophical aporia, but of course application to constitutional analysis needs to be worked out much more carefully. So I'm aware that I'm using all of my time and I'm not even to the end of the findings. But just a couple of more notions. So these are attentional modifications in absorption. Can go into flesh with this layering, can go into internal space, can go into collapse of intentional relations and sort of open awareness that will be more Dzogchen variation. Internal space will be more isochastic, space of stillness. Flesh will be in Tantra, Hridaya Tantras, Buddhist Tantras of the 11th century have the same layering, or also can happen in Yesikyasmi as the poem that I was reporting. So those experiences can happen as induced by meditative practice, or they can happen spontaneously in certain types of psycho-spiritual development. And so here, this is a very old slide from a longitudinal study of emergent spiritual experiences and people who, in New Age groups, self-identified as so-called Kundalini process. So bringing up Kundalini process is like mentioning devil to a well-intended group of people, because it's such a New Age, controversial notion associated with crazy behaviors, being hospitalized, etc. But there are peak experiences, and they appear in a certain sequence. So there is a sequencing of experience religious, in unfolding of religious or spiritual experience, and subjects of those experiences which are here, these are the peak experiences over time, and there is also another set of peak experiences grouped with around a different quality which happens, on the time axis again at a certain developmental period for those people. Actually, Jung wrote about Kundalini concept. And, those experiences, they have in the connection, and so people perceive them as a parallel current of consciousness, which takes one sort of out of irrelevance, out of this wane and waxing of unbroken qualities of experience that we all live in, into a different kind of experience, which is not characterized by intentionality as irrelevance is characterized, which has highlighted manifestations which are very difficult to explain in terms of Husserlian highlightings, and which has its own temporal organization, like a parallel time, and can be predicted when those models or developmental patterns of experience are known, then events can be predicted, and that was done in Sufism, that was done, of course, in Tantra Yoga a lot. And the modes of knowing which are emerging in those experiences, they will be certainly non-intentional, and knowledge of something, when something knows itself by itself. But in most cases, those experiences, they have this component of phenomenological materiality, component of changed tactility. And sometimes when the reduction or the absorption is complete, like in this meditation on Vedanta verses that I mentioned, there is nothing remaining but a sense of tangible presence which doesn't have a spatial constitution to it because it was discarded. It doesn't have a temporal horizon because that was discarded. And so those horizons re-emerge when mystic emerges from absorption, but it's not that those horizons are, that hyletics or primal impression exists in those horizons, or there is some kind of pure seeing that can constitute this kind of conditions. But on the contrary, horizon of time and the horizon of space, and then certainly intentional positing happens in the horizon of phenomenological materiality, while when people are there in this materiality naked, the only thing that they can bring out of that is sense of certainty. So it's like this bottom ground of all reductions which available through subjectivity and informs the rising appearances, and that's, of course, that's Henri's system, but it's not hyletics which is used in this analysis. So the questions which are more than answers here is how really the constitution of primal impression would be viewed in a system like this. So I tried very schematically and crudely, I must say, here compare Husserlian view of the structure of consciousness with the structure of consciousness in Henri. So in Husserl's view, and again, forgive me for the terrible simplification of this, but there is this hyletic matrix, and then hyletic matrix, there is this intentional relationship object-subject-object which are emerging in reflection on the sort of primal impression, in primal impression. And then there are various intentionalities which kind of spring from that, or at least that's how I understand it. And so when we analyze religious experience according to this model, this is the horizon where we dwell, meaning making. This is where I think most of the studies are located, or at best, if we are talking about the intentional constitutional experience, that's where it will be. It doesn't really move there. That will be structural consciousness in Henri, world and object, subject and object, world and self. They are substantiated by materiality, which is sentience and life giving direct perception. It's a matrix. It's not a speculative concept as mentioned by a previous speaker, but it's an actual direct perception. And so so another slide which I tried to use for the same purpose, it's like as if out of this matrix intentionalities emerge. Why would they emerge? Because the matrix is not inert, but because there is a phenomenal quality to this matrix, which is materiality or substantiality or tangibility, sentience. And so what's called self-affection in many interpretive studies on Henri, he also calls sentience, meaning capacity to feel itself by itself. Mm. And so sentience, if you can imagine set of mirrors, you know, something which is endlessly mirroring itself. We'll give mirrors facing one another. There will be this spread of intentionalities in a mirror-like manner. So that's, one can argue that maybe ontological assumptions are not bracketed out here. And I have the whole talk filled by quotes from Henri and quotes from Husserl, and which kind of juxtapose those perspectives and juxtaposing those perspectives and allow to make sense out of their differences. But I do think that this kind of model gives more space in analyzing emergence of religious connotations in experience, because they are not interpretive. They are innate to unveilings in which this phenomenological materiality is directly given. And what are those unveilings? Different modes of knowledge, different angles under which we get absorbed into those worlds. So this is, again, a direction of inward motions of attention. Disregard, please, highlighting reduction. Again, that's the residue of my clumsy attempts to explain something like this in the past, before I read Aliyev. But these are the modes of attention which are in people's account. That's the refocusing which is happening, and these are just some of them. So attention, instead of being spread out, being in a sense of a, I call it sometimes when I teach, it's a vagal mode, like there is nobody home and everything is on periphery. So it turns into a sort of, it turns onto itself, it dives into this materially phenomenological or phenomenological material body. But it does so in a variety of different ways. This is the orthogonal absorption towards the sense of cell, but there are many, many things which happen down there with the attentional configuration of self-awareness. And so dependent on how mind is pulled in, there appear to be different manifestations of materiality. So phenomenological materiality comes through in many different variations, and hence Sufism talks about 47 modes of knowing of the divine. There are also other models which expand the epistemology of ordinary consciousness into a variety of embodied absorptive modes. And when those modes take place, then experience acquires religious connotations or connotations of the sacred, etc. But I think that this, if this is really true and not something that I, in a manner of first person, phenomenological self-examinations lifted in my imaginal variations from this mess of accounts, then I think we can explain and describe the emergence of sacred in experience or emergence of transcendence. Because, by the way, in Henri's system there is no notion of transcendence. Because phenomenological materiality is the essence of appearances, transcendence will be happening as a intentional phenomena, like here, of course, there will be a transcendence, but where would you transcend if everything is phenomenologically material? Phenomenologically material, not physically. So, this gives also the possibility to, that's why I'm charmed by to Qualia of God, because there is phenomenal quality to the experience of God. There is tangibility to experience of God. There is tangibility to the sacred, which is coming from those accounts. For Henri, thought is phenomenological material thought in general. But of course, in religious experience, it's in a much more naked way, in the form of unveiling. And so, and again, dependent on where in the body this is happening, the connotations will be different. So please forgive me for digressing from my text, but I realized that it was of such an impossible length that I would, you know, nobody will have dinner. I conceptualized it sufficiently for discussion. So I welcome your questions. Maybe we have a few minutes of questions. It's okay, but I have I'd like critique from Brazilians.
I just read, because if you would like critique of the surveillance,
I do,
which I'm not completely, but I agree with your points. I agree with your urge to reconceptualize self, but to your distinguishing between Husserl and Hanery, I think you are missing one important layer of Husserl's work, which is from his very beginning, which is what he calls stream of consciousness. So for him, the ego or the consciousness has two basic layers. One is the objective consciousness, the intentional, and then the streaming consciousness, actually without subjectivity. And I think Andre is fine, but I think if we connect these two layers in Husserl together, we get something very similar to Andre. So I agree with you, but I think Husserl is not your like enemy.
No, I absolutely think I stand in Husserl. More often than I think.
It's interesting that this also connects Husserl to William James.
I agree with you. I cannot claim that this all is worked out. Henri wrote his whole material phenomenology, and then further in his work Incarnation, he again and again tried to differentiate himself from exactly that interpretation of his findings. For him, phenomenological materiality is not hyletics, because hyletics for him is a secondary concept to layered-over intersectionality, and even when awareness is non-objectifying awareness, I mean, it still remains. So my preparation for this talk was the work of Taipale, you know, which is the most, I think, recent and very comprehensive study of Husserlian subjectivity. I think that he misses on in this analysis in some subtle distinctions that were established by Henry himself. But again, Husserl's body of work is so voluminous, and there is this round of self-correction. So, what I actually wanted to refer to is your prior comment on language. When Jana, you were talking about Sojourner Cross, and you mentioned language. There is a very interesting phenomenon which I don't yet know how to deal with. In those absorptive states, there is a condition that Indians call Jeda Samadhi, meaning absorption which is inert. So sometimes people get absorbed and they're just sitting there and nothing is happening. I'm familiar with that myself. Like you get in there and then so what? And so then they say, give greetings. The moment I say, I don't even need to say God or the name of God, I can say just hi and hello. The moment this is even conceived, experience immediately acquires a connotation of the sacred. And it's hard to say what is going on there. I mean, theologically, I love this idea. It's just my poetic mind. Constitutively, I don't know whether intentionality ignited the experience, or this is the meaning of subjectivity which is brought in, or this is something which we don't know about language, because there are people who interpret verbal cardis or aquinas as wounds emerging from flesh, so maybe it's just more open questions, but I think that it's important to constitutively study those experiences all the way with all the, you know, those gaps in meaning which are in all those descriptions, you know, because they are developmental and they are embodied, and then of course they write something out in which it's not the full phenomenological account, unfortunately. So, yeah, I know. If there are no questions,
this is actually a quick comment because I'm very surprised to hear you mention Shankara and his Advaita Vedanta philosophy. So I am wondering that if we could use this to maybe like articulate a phenomenological interpretation of Shankara's ideas.
Wait, you know, I'm a comparativist, and I spent 10 years in my life teaching Vedanta. So I know the field. There is no Vedanta or one single Shankara. There are Shankaras and Vedantas, and they're quite inconsistent in between themselves. And then second, I think that it's a very difficult task because the reductions are not the same. I mean, of course, Husserl is a master of reduction. I mean that actually, I think that his discovery of non-actional intentionality would be the most applicable for those studies. But it's a different kind of reduction in each case. So that's why the cross-system comparison, they become very difficult, because that's why I think phenomenology cannot be layered on top of Buddhism. Descriptive method, description we can do. We can give somebody a verse in Vedanta or interview with a practitioner and see what happens. Phenomenology of Vedanta was actually written, of Vedanta as Vedantic philosophy, was written down by Gupta, I think Bina Gupta. And I think that she got it as far as it's possible to get it, but I think that these are really systems which have to be studied as separate possibilities of human consciousness, as you rightly so brought it up, with different axiologies, different goals. What he does in what I read, he works off ordinary experience. And that's the issue, you know, I hope that we'll have next dialogue on first person authority in those studies. Because neither Henri, nor Marion, nor even Conrad Martius, none of theological phenomenologists talks about religious or spiritual experience, really. Like what Bob was talking about, this kind of studies, I think, are exceptionally rare. So Henri works off ordinary experience, uncovering the nature of materiality. Then he posits that there is no transcendence in this notion. And then he says that the body and subjectivity comes into this system, and then he stops. And then he starts writing about sexuality and proceeds towards analysis of Christian revelation, and it becomes very theological, and he doesn't develop the analysis anything. So in honesty, I don't know what he would say about it. I can speculate that he would probably say that materiality is the essence of appearances and that we can posit inside and outside. but in a religious or spiritual experience, that's a part of their natural attitude. So it's that's where mystic begins, because this spiritologist distinction inside and outside is essential. And so how embodiment plays into this layering, how does it work itself into this material matrix? How does it, why do people experience degrees of different vibrations?
Yeah, this is perhaps for me, or I think it's generally, in Christianity there is the, the idea of incarnation. It has such a potential also philosophically, it's so full. What would it mean when you took it in consequences? Incarnation may mean it. For me, what you were saying was going this direction also.
Mm-hmm.
And also, what is interesting, like John of the Cross, he's using when he has this movement inside and he glimpses something inside, he has an expression that he glimpses uno se que, like something I don't know what, he calls it. And then he says, and I am able to find something uno se que, something I don't know what, when I'm overwhelmed by the beauty of the nature, for example. It's also outside. The same thing, which is overwhelming from inside. So
okay.
This interconnectedness of all, let's say, creation and created and uncreated.
This I can perhaps a little bit resonate with or comment upon. I did a little bit of studies of this when it's this you know, nature. Aware, self-awareness subliminally expands inward at the same time. And it's hard to catch, but when you were talking about the dome, and I asked you a question whether there was an expansion of awareness inward. This was because I observed this, or this phenomenon was reported. If you really question, okay, what happened with your self-awareness, there is an element in absorption at the same time as there is this element of spirit. So it's just that probably the inside and outside are not just as clear-cut at all, which is Henri's point in the absence of transcendence, but where mystics begin, they begin with this distinction, and then that can be temporarily co-constituent in some ways. So that makes sense. Okay, I think that everybody is ready for dinner.